It's been long enough that I'm ready to tell this story. Last year, I was dog-sitting for my aunt. The dog is small, sweet, and a little skittish. I had to work for most of the week, and I was just living in the house for the time being. It's a nice house, not big enough to feel empty if you're alone, but not small enough to feel cramped. The only rooms I used were the kitchen, bathroom, living room, and the guest bedroom. My last day of work this particular week was a double shift. I was excited because after this I had 2 days off. I planned on using them to introduce the dog to RuPaul's Drag Race. I usually try to keep good spirits for a double shift because regardless of the time and annoying customers, extra money is always needed. My old job was a barista and cashier. Mornings are always busy and nights are slow. On weekends, people are more concerned with coffee and breakfast than anything else we may have to offer. I was having a nice time actually, because this day was turning out to be not as hectic as the previous ones that week. As the morning rush line was dwindling, the limited tables in the restaurant came into view, and I started people watching. As I slowly scanned the customers eating bagels and reading the paper, my eyes met a man at a laptop. He had long, dirty hair with a bit of stubble. He stared at me with a bit too much intensity. I wondered if he found my people watching rude, so I decided to clean and restock instead. It didn't take long for a line to reform, so I returned to my register. Once again, after the line died down, I could see the few tables in the front. The man was still there, and he was still staring at me. Every now and then, he would look at his computer and then back to me. It almost felt like he was looking right through me, or like he could see every part of me. It felt so uncomfortable that I went and cleaned in the back of the restaurant, out of his sight. After the next rush, I took my break. I sat far away from the man. He was out of my sight, and I was out of his. When I came back from my break, the man was gone. My manager had asked if I had interacted with him at all. I told her about him making eye contact with me, but that nothing else really happened. She told me that the man had been watching some pretty explicit stuff on his laptop. She had asked him to leave, so that was weird enough. This man had been watching stuff and staring at me. I really wish that was where the story stopped. Hours passed, and the rest of the day was entirely normal, despite me and a few female co-workers feeling a slight edge. We were in the process of closing, which is actually a process I really enjoy. We're well in, and I'm almost done with my assigned jobs, when my manager comes up to me again. She informs me that the man had found his way back into the restaurant at some point. She found him hiding in a back corner. She chased him out by threatening to call the police. She knew that earlier in the day, he seemed to be paying attention to me. She said I could finish up whatever I wanted or needed to. But afterwards, she strongly advised me to get home as soon as possible. She also offered to walk me to my car. I took both offers and quickly got my things together and clocked out. My aunt's house was not far from work. It was a 5-minute drive at most, which was helpful because then I didn't feel crippling anxiety for much longer. I got in the house, and after triple-checking that I had locked every door, I got into my pajamas. But unsurprisingly, I was not ready to sleep yet. Now was the time to introduce the dog to RuPaul's Drag Race. I went into the living room. The living room consists of a couch, 2 chairs, a TV, a window, and the front door. Unfortunately, the porch light was broken, and the window had no curtains. That had me a little stressed out, but I was willing to take that over the only other TV in the house, which was the one that exists in the scary basement. Facing the basement TV included having my back to a sliding glass door facing the very dark woods. No thanks. I was setting up the TV when the dog started growling. I really didn't think much of it. As I said, the dog is skittish, so he growls and barks all the time. I wasn't looking at him. I was muttering, shush, shush, and figuring out how to work the TV. The dog didn't stop, and started to get louder, so I finally put down the remote and turned to face the dog. I froze. The dog was barking at the window, and there was an outline of a man at the window. The exact same build as the one at the restaurant. I screamed, and luckily that was enough for the man to run away from the window. I stood there, frozen for a while. The dog had calmed down, but I hardly felt safe. So I went into the kitchen, grabbed a big knife, and did what any responsible adult would do. I called my mommy. She did not advise calling the police, and instead came and spent the night with me. I told my aunt. I spent the rest of my time dog-sitting, clutching the knife anytime I slept or took a shower. My aunt also gave me permission to have one friend stay with me every night. Nothing else ever happened. I never even saw the guy come into work again. A part of me wishes I knew who he was or where he went, or what he even wanted with me. I'm glad he was a coward, and that all it took to scare him off was my scream and an extra small dog. So when I was 13, my friend Mary had a grandma who ran a nail salon downtown. I grew up in a really, really small town in Alaska. When I was younger, it seemed like a really safe place. As I got older, I realized just how corrupt and horrible it actually was. But at 13, I still wasn't totally aware of that. After school, Mary and I would always walk to her grandma's nail salon. It was in a building with a few other shops. We would kind of just hang out there and browse. It was a Thai restaurant that was our favorite ever. We'd eat there a lot too, and were pretty good friends with the restaurant owners. After some months of the same routine, just hanging out every day caused me and Mary's family to become like family. Her grandmother, Gretchen, had the idea of wanting to open a little coffee shop stand in there. The other shops were a cookware store, a clothes consignment shop, a game shop, and a couple other random ones, so we figured it would have been a nice business. She wanted Mary and I to work the coffee stand while she was in the nail salon. I partly believe it was that she just simply wanted us out of her hair. Anyway, we went and trained properly, but since we were 13, we were being paid under the counter. We had set it up right in front of the Thai restaurant. After about a week of the coffee stand of being up and running, this guy started visiting who looked to be about 18 to 20 years old. He would get a small vanilla latte every day and sit in the mall and kind of watch us work. He would also browse around the game shop, so we just kind of thought that maybe he lived nearby and liked to come there every day. Maybe we hadn't noticed him because he obviously wouldn't be coming in to get his nails done. He honestly looked kind of dirty and like he didn't care that much. When the months got hotter, we started walking home instead of her mom driving us. There were a lot of kids walking around, so I didn't notice very much if people were behind or in front of me. One of the nights, we closed up shop a little late. It was about 9 p.m., which in Alaska is still fully sunny, and I noticed that someone was walking behind me kind of close. I stopped dead in my tracks and didn't hear anything, so I kept walking. And then I was sure I heard it again. I turned around, and there he was. The same guy that was in the mall every day, following me. I was 13 and shy, so I just kept walking and made a loop around. I walked to the mayor's office because the police station was too far. I called my dad from there because I felt safe. He came and got me. This repeated in slightly different ways for about 2 weeks. And eventually, to this day, I don't know how, he found out where I lived. He would knock on the door, leave flowers, call our home phone, all kinds of crazy stuff. My dad finally helped me get a restraining order, but it took about a month to get anyone to take us seriously and come see him at my workplace, as we had no idea what his name was. Once that was in effect, it stopped for only about a week, and he started showing up again. He continued stalking my home and even hanging out by the fence of my school when school was back in session. Finally, I had had enough. I had moved in with my mom because she was, frankly, a better parent to me and taking it way more seriously. She lived so far out that I couldn't walk anywhere. She had no electricity or running water, but I didn't care anymore. I felt so much safer and so much more loved. I quit that job. I took the bus every day. Eventually, he just disappeared, and I never heard about him ever again. So for a bit of background, I'm a female and at the time I was 20. I moved in with my uncle in San Antonio, Texas, with the agreement that I didn't have to pay rent as long as I helped him out with chores and my cousins. I got a job at a super known coffee chain downtown, close to the touristy part of the area. We had a lot of regulars and a lot of homeless people coming in and out. I felt relatively safe though, because I got to know people there. And it was almost always a lot of foot traffic. I used to even take walks after work in the area, especially since I was super close to the Riverwalk. Skip to a couple of months into the job. I was friends with everyone I worked with. We were all pretty close. On this particular day, it was one of my co-workers' last days. There were about three guys who had been in there almost all morning. They hadn't bought anything and were just hanging out, which was not unusual for my location. On my break, I decided to walk to a nearby drugstore so I can get a few farewell cards and maybe a small gift for said coworker. I walked out and put my earphones in, and before I could even press play, I hear the door open behind me and footsteps following behind. Whoever it was caught up to me and started walking beside me, matching my pace exactly. I turned to look, and it was one of the guys that had been there all morning. He was a bit taller than me and reminded me a lot of Lakeith Stanfield. He tried to ask for my number and I kindly told him no. He persisted and I, with a short temper, told him to fuck off. He stopped and stared at me in surprise, as I don't look like someone who speaks up or is rude. He stood there as I walked away, and by the time I went back, they were all gone. I proceeded to tell my coworkers about the encounter and we laughed it off. I thought that would be the end of it. I was wrong. Every shift after that, he would already be there just hanging out, or would walk in mid-shift. Sometimes with somebody else and sometimes by himself. I assumed he was just another homeless person, because how else was he always able to be around? My shifts were sporadic. Sometimes I opened. Some days I closed, some days I worked the mid, but it didn't matter, he was always there. At that point, I started feeling paranoid. I would always catch him staring in my direction. He never ordered anything, never talked to me, and luckily wouldn't follow me. He would just sit there, watching me. I started mentioning it to my coworkers, and they started noticing it too. One of my team leaders would help me out by sending me to clean the dishes in the back, or even organize the cooler. My coworkers would also try and place themselves to try to block me from his view. I started feeling uncomfortable at work. Sometimes when I closed, a coworker would walk me to my car before heading home themselves. Or if I didn't close, they would walk me to my car and turn around and head back to work. Then one day of him just staring, I was working at the register that day. He walked up and ordered a water. I asked for his name for his order. I now had his first name just in case. He took his water and sat down. I had mentioned him before to my manager, but because he hadn't really done anything, we couldn't do anything besides note it in the manager book. The next day, I worked with my manager. It was him, two other co-workers, and me. I told them I had to go to the bathroom real quick. There were two bathrooms right next to each other, but sort of hidden from the coffee bar and register, and they weren't gender specific. I walked around the bar to the lobby area. I had to pass by his table and walk down the lobby to get to the bathrooms. I noticed him get up before going inside the bathroom. I sat down to do my business when someone rattled the knob. I shouted out that it was occupied, but whoever it was kept rattling the door until I finished. When I opened the door, no one was there. Walking back, I noticed him adjusting back into his chair. I was really freaked out and told my boss. He couldn't tell him anything because we had no proof that it was him. Later that shift, he got up and picked up a coffee from the pickup area. My boss assumed he had ordered it and let him take it. I told him it wasn't, and that wasn't even his name. My boss used this as an opportunity to tell him, if he does something like that again, he can't come back. The man apologized and actually stuck to the rules every day after that. He went back to just watching me. And now cut to Valentine's Day. One of my team leaders and I would schedule to work certain Thursdays after close to deep clean the store. We would stay until 1 a.m. This was one of those Thursdays. We were almost done and I had to clean the bathrooms as one of the last chores. I finished, and as I walk out of the bathroom, I see him peeking in with both hands pressed to the window, eyes wide, just staring at me with his really intense look. I froze for a second, just staring back. I notice on one of his palms that is pressed to the window, a purple foam heart. He doesn't move at all. I freak out and run back into the bathroom. I shout, "Hannah, Hannah, he's here, he's back." She barely hears me through the music we were blasting. Hannah was the team lead who had helped me hide from him, so she knew the huge fear I had towards him. She walks towards the bathroom, shouting back, "What are you saying? What's going on?" As soon as she gets close, she sees him. I told her again, "He's here. He's watching me." She started shouting through the window, "You need to leave. If you don't, we're calling the police." I step out a bit to see if he'll leave. He is ignoring her. His eyes were fixated in my direction. I step back into the bathroom and my lead continues to shout at him. She tells him to leave again and threatens him with the police. About 5 minutes pass, and he realizes that I'm not stepping out until he leaves. So he does. The next day, my lead and I told my manager I want to file a police report. He tells me no, to wait until he talks to his boss. He shows up again that day, but I was only there to talk to my manager and leave right after. When I got home, a friend convinced me to call the cops. So I message my boss that I don't care what he or his boss says. I'm scared and I'm going to file that report. I dial 911 and tell them a summarized version. They tell me that they're going to send someone to where I live to take an official report. The officers were so nice and supportive. I told them my whole story and how my boss didn't feel the need to get the cops involved since I wasn't harmed. The officers told me that I should have called right away and defend me, saying they can get him for harassment. I thank them, and they tell me if he shows up again to dial 911, so they can take him in for trespassing and harassing. I think that day my manager banned him and warned him, because he never showed up to the coffee shop again. A few months later, when I was comfortable again with downtown, I went out with some friends to walk around. We were close to where I worked, and as we round a corner, I see him. So I ducked into a little corner store and my friends follow. I told them I saw him and they kept an eye out. Once he was out of view, we left the store. That was the last time I saw him. I will share an incident that happened to me last October. It was 10 a.m. on a weekday. I had the day off, so I decided to go to the grocery store and get some pumpkins to carve. I did my shopping without any problems, didn't notice anything was off since it was earlier in the day and the other shoppers were elderly. I bought 3 large pumpkins and had them in a cart to put them in the trunk of my car. As I was putting the first pumpkin in my trunk, I feel someone pulling the pumpkin out of my arm backwards. I spun around and threw the pumpkin in the process, to see 2 men directly behind me. I am a very small woman, so I immediately felt endangered. The one man who I assumed was a man who first grabbed at me made an attempt to scream at me in a language I didn't understand, and he grabbed at me again. I pushed the cart with the remaining pumpkins at the two men, got in my car to lock the doors, and drove away. The two men got into a white, brand new Dodge Charger that had temp plates and sped out of the parking lot after me. The street we both pulled out on was a busy, four-lane, 25-mile-per-hour business district. You can't safely speed. That didn't matter to the Dodge Charger, who weaved in and out of traffic to try and run me off the road. The driving was so erratic that another driver attempted to box the Charger in. It didn't matter much. They went into oncoming traffic anyway. Meanwhile, I threw my left turn signal on and made a quick right into a coffee and donut chain I regularly frequent. Next to this coffee chain is a pizza chain. I noticed the Charger had pulled into this pizza chain and was waiting for me to pull out of the coffee chain parking lot. I frantically told the employee what was going on through the drive-thru while I ordered a snack. I was there and didn't want to have to pull out yet. This coffee chain knows me well, and on this day, the manager went above and beyond the call of duty. She called the police, who told her to have me pull around to the window. She did, knowing I would be in full view of the Charger. So she came outside to stand between us with the biggest rolling pin I've ever seen in my life. She stared those men down like my own mother would have. The cops came and took statements. The Charger was still there and searched. One officer told me they pulled tarp and a rope from the trunk, and that they were treating this as a trafficking attempt. Both men refused to answer any questions and were arrested. I don't know for sure what their intent was, but I live in a sanctuary city with mostly people from Nepal or Bhutan. I've never had a scary issue. I love my neighborhood, but I did not recognize these men or their car frequenting the neighborhood. That day I bought everyone working at the coffee chain a gift certificate for a massage as a thank you for protecting me. And I still tip them every morning extra, a year later. This took place about 8 years ago. I'd been single for a very long time. My kids kept telling me to get back into the swing of things, but I just kept making excuses. My nephew told me about this dating site. He said there was no harm in talking to people, so I did. I put everything out there. There were no surprises when or if they met me. I thought that if they still contacted me after reading all I had described myself, and we matched, then maybe I would have coffee with them. Well, I matched with a few, and the conversations went well. I met with one gentleman who was way too regimental for my crazy life, and kindly declined any more involvement with him. Another guy seemed too pushy, and acted like I should be honored to be in his presence. But then there came Richard. Now please keep in mind, I had very low self-esteem at the time. That being said, Richard seemed great. We carried on conversations for hours. He lived an hour and a half away, so all we could really do was talk to each other. We talked about our kids, dreams, goals. My daughter even friended one of his sons on Facebook. I was a secretary for some self-help meetings in my town, and he was going to school to be a counselor. Perfect, right? We talked for at least 4 months, but after a while, I noticed that he kept having small problems come up. Arguments with his mom, with whom he was living. No money for gas. His truck broke down. His oldest boy was mad at him. Just little things, you know. Not anything that would set me off. But it was his poor me, to hell with it attitude. I tried to let that go, and really be a positive influence in his life. His mother and boys loved me. They told me that they had never seen him so happy. Time went on, and we were still talking every day. I had an opportunity to come see him. And of course, my daughter went with me, so she could meet his son in person as well. I took him and his son out to eat at the only little coffee shop in that town. He knew I was on a fixed income, but I paid anyway because he was going to school. and didn't have an income as of yet. We had a great time. We met at his son's house on a hilltop town. We were having such a good time that we didn't notice that the snow was coming down hard and the roads were icing up. So my daughter and I stayed the night in one of the rooms. It seemed like the closer we got to his family, the more distant they became to him. It was odd. The next day, the roads were clear, so we said our goodbyes and went home. But before we left, I received one extra hug from his son's mother-in-law. She whispered into my ear, "Do not fall for him." I thought that maybe there was something she didn't like about me. That came out of left field. The next few days we didn't talk. I thought that was odd. Did I do something wrong? Someone from the self-help meeting told me that there was a man looking for me. She said he looked disheveled and smelled like alcohol. This wasn't a surprise to me because I had helped quite a few people get back on their feet. Maybe this one fell off the wagon and just needed to talk. As I was driving down my street, I saw a truck in my driveway. I didn't recognize at first. It was him. He found out where I lived and was sitting in front of my house. At first I was happy, until I looked in his truck and saw him slumped over, reeking of booze. At that point, my fix mode set in, and I asked him in for some strong coffee. He told me that he had a blowout with his mother. She'd kicked him out, and his boys won't talk to him. I got him some clean clothes and told him to take a shower. I figured we could sort it out the next day. In the meantime, I was taking him to a meeting. He sobered up and agreed to go, but the whole time at the meeting, my friends were acting like I had lost my mind. Did they see something I was blind to? We went back to my house and he seemed okay, almost too okay, like nothing at all had happened. My son pulled me aside and told me he didn't like him much. But I thought that maybe he was just being overprotective. I should have paid more attention. We went to the store because I wasn't prepared for the extra mouth. I bought 4 liters of soda, a gallon of milk, 2 monsters for both him and my son, some chips and other things for dinner. After we ate, we all watched some TV and headed off to bed. I let him sleep on the spare bed in my room, but in the middle of the night, he tried to get frisky. At that point, no. My grown kids were in the other room, and something just didn't sit well with me. It was like he wasn't the same man he was before. The next morning, my daughter came out of the bathroom angry. She said in a loud voice, "Someone pissed all over the toilet." He didn't say a word. Later we were all eating breakfast, and he started to let food drop out of his mouth onto the table and floor, and was spitting food while he was talking. He took 3 2-liters and drank them back to back, letting some run down his chin. What the hell? Then, yes, there is more. He took the remote and started setting future recordings for his favorite shows, and even deleting a few of my grandchildren's. He set recordings for weeks in advance. "Wait, wait, wait. What are you doing, my friend? This is not cool," I told him, but he acted like I said nothing. Then he went to the refrigerator and told me that I had to go to the store to buy more soda and stuff, because it was all gone. I mean, it was all gone. He even drank my son's monster and the whole gallon of milk, all in one day. At this point, my daughter was also livid, so she contacted his son. He proceeded to tell her that Richard's mother kicked him out, because he wouldn't get a job and was stealing money, and eating her out of house and home. His other son wouldn't talk to him, because he keeps asking for money and won't pay it back. He himself was mad at him for lying to me by telling me he was going to school when he wasn't and using me as his next big meal ticket. Well, that was it. I got all of his stuff together and took it to his truck. I asked him to leave. It doesn't end there. He had loosened some bolts on his transmission, making it impossible to move. He begged and pleaded for me to let him stay. At this point, snot was coming out of his nose. Good God. He said that he just wanted to be close to me, and if that meant sleeping in his truck, he would do that, and he could not live without me. No, I called his oldest son and told them that if they didn't come with a tow truck and get their dad, his fate was not going to be nice. They arrived 2 hours later, apologizing for their father's actions. We found out through his son that for many years, he'd gone through quite a few unhealthy relationships. He took advantage of a lot of women that fell for his lies. He still tries to find me on Facebook to this day. Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed that one. Do me a favor and like and comment. Subscribe if you haven't, and hit the bell icon to turn on notifications. If you fancy taking a look at my channel memberships, Patreon, or any of my social medias, all my links are in the description below. I want to give a shout out to my patrons and channel members for supporting the channel. So a huge thanks to Something Edgy, Pretty Girl 215, Borderline Betty, Sarah C, Blazed Goddess, Christopher, Spider's Web, Ooh La La Andrea, Lady Drakkard, Sue, Absinthe Alice, Rochelle, Astara Ray, Monique, Crafty Kel, Monica Levelace, Emma, Sean Gorman, Skittles MM, Gabrielle, Serafina Nightingale, Misanthropia, Fluby, Ryan, Brenda, Rudy, Christina De La Rosa, Noosh, Lulu Rogers, Fire 05, Linda, Shan, Jody, Sarah P, Kathleen Fenton, James Gargano, Gemma Allen, Alex, and Courtney Maxwell. Thanks for listening, guys. I hope you had a great week. I'll see you all on the next one.